Thank you for joining us today. This is Condo Insider, and I'm Jane Sugimura. I'm your co-host for this show. This is a show for condominium residents and board members and people who deal with condos. We deal with condo issues, and we have a really interesting topic today, new technology, which I'm sure all of you will be interested in. I know I live in a high-rise, and we've been trying for years to get PV coverage, and we've been told we can't do it because the building is too dense, and now there seems to be a solution for that. And my guest today, his name is Stephen Walicki. Mm-hmm. And he is an independent PV consultant. And Steve, tell us about yourself.
Thank you. Well, first of all, thank you for having me on the show. Appreciate it. Aloha. I am originally from Milwaukee, Wisconsin. Kind of similar to Hawaii in many ways. Very friendly people. Weather's a little different, but mm-hmm. the people seem to be pretty similar. I've lived in Hilo and installed solar over on the Big Island. Really love Hilo. I've worked for Hawaii Energy here in Honolulu for a year. And recently been working for a contractor. And now I am doing some independent consulting. I've also, I would say, one of the most interesting things about me that sets me apart from people is I sailed across the Pacific on a 30-foot sailboat.
Wow.
So when it comes to renewable energy, I have lived off of solar panels for 5 years. I've lived off of batteries. I've had to catch my rain. So I'm very near and dear to me, renewable energy and off-grid living and all these things. I've actually done it, lived it. I have a little bit of insight into that kind of lifestyle. And we're trying to ultimately get Hawaii to ultimately function like a sailboat.
Well, you know, the state of Hawaii has established a deadline to be in energy independent. I think it's 2045, right.
2045 and 2035 for the university. So okay. The university has to be there 10 years before.
And so you're going to be talking today about building integrated photovoltaic, yes. BIPV.
BIPV.
What yes. is it?
Okay, so BIPV is something most people don't know about yet, but it stands for Building Integrated Photovoltaics.
Okay.
The main gist of it is we're taking normal parts of your building and turning it into solar.
Like, what parts of your building are you talking about?
So we can take primarily what the technology is doing. We're taking glass, generally. Windows is the biggest thing that BIPV is. We can take your windows and replace windows with solar-producing transparent windows. It looks like a window. You can see through it, but it generates electricity. We also can use the same technology for lanai railings and lanai glass, where before you just had some bars and some lanai glass. Now we can put actual solar panels there that will also be transparent, but they generate electricity. And the other final thing that is really out there right now is floor tiles. So if you have a courtyard out, a pool deck or a courtyard, we can actually put solar panel floor tiles that generate electricity as well.
Well, with the floor panels, can you walk on it?
Yes. The floor tiles are actually rated for, their non-skid rating is all handicapped approved, so it actually has a little bit of grit to it, has a little bit of rough bump to it, so you can actually walk with crutches on it, and it passes national tests for that. And it is it's glass, and absolutely, there's a couple colleges so far in the U.S. that have it implemented. So far in Hawaii, it hasn't been done yet. So we're really excited to get it out here and to get.
But are there any projects who have initiated work to install this type of product in Hawaii?
Yes, there are. We're working with a couple developers right now. There's the whole idea of retrofitting a building can be a bit clumsy, and we're trying to do with new construction is really where this comes into play. For a developer, he can opt to use a traditional floor tile, or he can use a solar BIPV floor tile. So we actually have put together a proposal for a new developer, where we have actually shown that it's far less expensive to put in our solar floor tiles as opposed to the original sunk cost of regular floor tiles. So those should be rolling out fourth quarter this year. So it's pretty exciting, yeah.
But you know what, there's something in Hawaii with high rises, you know, what seems to be a big item.
Yeah.
The windows have to be replaced. You know, the sides are, you know, failing so that the rain is coming in. So and that is a big ticket item.
Yes.
When you have to replace the windows in a high rise.
Yes.
Can this product be used to replace the windows that now have to replace in a high rise?
Absolutely. That's actually the most exciting part of this building, integrated photovoltaics. Instead of going through the whole nightmare of changing or removing the glass and resealing it to stop these water leaks and put back your old glass, it's probably 40 years old, which is kind of a standard age around here for glass, you can start fresh with a solar window. You'll get brand new frames around the whole thing. Tax credits, actually over 100% of it is going to be covered in tax benefits.
Let me ask you, how much does all this cost? I mean, is it more expensive than replacing it with regular glass?
Yes, so that's a great question, and that's the biggest question. So it's two answers. One is it's more expensive and it's less expensive. So the initial cost is usually 1.5 to 2 times the traditional glass. However, with the tax credits that are currently in place, 30% is the federal tax credit, 35% is the state tax credit. That comes up to 65% of the system is actually covered in solar tax credits.
Except that condos are nonprofits, so they can't take the tax credits. So how
Correct.
Do they get take advantage of the fact that tax credits are available?
Right, and this is a standard situation for condos and for associations. PPAs, so a power purchase agreement, is the standard way of letting associations access this technology and take advantage and monetize these tax benefits, but through a third party. So basically a third party investor will come in and own the product and then sell you power. And so this has been going on in Hawaii for quite a while. Putting solar panels on the roof. If you can't afford it, you can still put solar panels on the roof. Another company will own it, and they'll just sell you discounted power. So now you get solar, and maybe save a penny or two on your kilowatt hours from the utility.
And what's the buyback? What's the usual buyback period for this? If you were to allow an investor to come in and pay for the glass to be put in,
yes,
and then basically lease it from them, what is the buyback period?
Well, there's in the PPA, in the power purchase agreement, there's buyout times and different times in the contract that you can purchase. The association can actually buy out the whole system. Mm-hmm. The depreciation schedule out there right now is it's going to take 5 years for this asset to actually be depreciated. So we usually don't see the associations wanting to purchase this until after those depreciation benefits are taken out as well. So those depreciation benefits on top of your 65%, then the rest of it is actually this depreciation. It'll come over 100%. So an investor will come in, he'll put his money in, say $1 million, put $1 million into a glass project, and he'll come out with $1,070,000. Actually come out as about $70,000 above his initial investment. For the association, of course, the investor wants to make a return on his money. So he can actually, if you were the owner of the building and had all the tax liabilities yourself, the payback could be under 2 years. We model paybacks from 2 to 5 years in those models where you're the tax owner, where you're the actual, where you see your tax liability. But if you're the association, of course, the owner, the investor is going to shave a little bit of profit for himself, and you can expect under 10-year payback periods for the associations. However, we're still working on ways to get a little hooey going within the association. So if you want to invest your money into this little LLC, then you can get a piece of those tax credits yourself.
You're talking about the unit owners who live in that building could then be part of the hooey, invest their money in the hooey, which will be the owner of the glass.
Absolutely.
And get the benefits of the tax credit and the payback.
Yes, and we think that's better than having a mainlander investor. It would be way more preferable to have the actual tenant owners, everyone say, okay, here's $5,000 investing, and they're going to pull out a little bit over $5,000 in tax credits over the next 5 years. This would be the best thing for everyone. Everyone is tied to it. They have their new glass. They're getting the tax credits themselves. And it's not mainland. I think that's...
And as part of your services as a consultant, would you be arranging for investors, you know, because with the association, I mean, they don't have the expertise or the wherewithal to go out and find these investors. So would you, the consultant or the contractor, be the entity or the person who would find these investors?
Yes, so that's something else that we bring to the table. We have high net worth individuals that have very large tax appetites that are trying to figure out what to do with their money, right? If they don't deploy this money, they have to pay taxes. And instead of paying taxes, they can invest in renewable energy and actually come out with a bit of a minor, but it's still a return. And that's not even including the energy sales or the final buyout. Just the tax play alone is really quite attractive.
And are there people out there who would be willing to do this?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. And there's people... Wall Street, there's plenty of people with tax appetites out there, large banks, large insurance companies that are looking for long-term investments, and these are safe long-term investments for them, tax investments.
And so that they would come in and they would be willing to come and finance these projects in Hawaii for a condominium who wanted to put in the product.
Absolutely. So for 100% financing, we can actually have a third party come in, pay for the whole project and invest in the project, put in a whole new building envelope for you. And the payments the association will make will be lower than what they would be saving to try to do this project in the future. A lot of these HOAs and associations are trying to save money. They might assess a new fee for the units to do these projects. Well, by having a third party come in and doing it right now and taking advantage of these tax credits while they're here, the association doesn't even need to raise their rates. In fact, with all the energy savings they're going to get out of the windows, it's really a no-brainer. It's actually such a no-brainer that people still find it hard to believe. It's
okay. So that means that the project, if an association were to decide that they want to install this project. The contractor or you as a consultant would be able to arrange for the financing.
That's right.
And that the payback would probably be about 10 years or less.
It can be under 10 years.
And then it would belong to the association.
That's right. And those are all terms of the power purchase agreement, how that it is all negotiable. Everything's negotiable. If you wanted to, as the association maybe had some reserves and said, hey, how about we put some money into this and we'll kind of buy down this power purchase agreement, maybe we can do that. You can depending on every building is different. Every building has different financial situations. Some people want a long fixed rate. Some people want a low beginning rate and a variable rate that's going to save them more money now so they can deploy to do other projects. It really depends on every building is a little bit different, but the money is there and there are investors that want to do it. The technology is there. You don't need to have a special assessment. You don't need to save up all this money and delay this project 5-6 years down the road. Right now is the window of opportunity, pardon the pun, but we have the tax credits right now. 30% in the federal tax credits right now are going to be going down to 22% by 2020. So that's an 8% reduction just in the next 2 years. And these projects take some time to get actually going, to do a whole building envelope like this. This is not a quick deal. So the permits, the ordering, everything, it really needs to be starting now if you want to get in on these really amazing tax incentives. There's also the possibility of the Hawaii state tax credit vanishing at some point as well. A lot of people, after the net metering closed, they felt, oh, why didn't I do that? Oh my gosh, the neighbor across the street has solar on his roof and I can't have it anymore. And this is going to be a similar situation. This is the window of time to actually do these projects and get all these large financial incentives.
Okay, well, we're going to take a break now for about a minute and then we're going to come back. Great. And you're going to tell us how these associations can save money.
Great.
Aloha, Howard Wig. I am the proud host of Code Green ThinkTech Hawaii. I appear every other Monday at 3 in the afternoon. Do not tune in the morning. My topic is energy efficiency. It sounds dry as heck, but it's not. We're paying $5 billion a year for imported oil. My job is to shave that down in homes and buildings while delivering better comfort, better light, better air conditioning, better everything. So if you're interested in your future, you'd better tune in to me. 3 o'clock every other Monday, Code Green. Aloha, and thank you very much.
Hello, thank you Welcome back. This is Jane Sugimura, co-host of Condo Insider, and I'm talking today with Stephen Walicki, who is an independent PV consultant, and we're talking about BIPV.
BIPV.
And so it's why should we care? Why should we care about BIPV?
Okay. Well, as Hawaii, we're mandated that we have to go 100% renewable by 2045, and most people don't even believe that's possible. Just because of the current technology, the bureaucracy behind everything, and people are really, how is this going to happen? It's doable with the implementation of batteries. Whenever we talk about renewable energy, we always come to the same energy storage problem. So really, every building out there has the potential to be off the grid.
Really, they have no choice, because now you can't be on the grid, right?
That's right. So now the net metering is now cut down. The only way we can do this is the consumer self-supply. So at this point, we need batteries, and the batteries are out there. There are different batteries. There's batteries with 20-year warranties that are non-flammable that are actually out there with financing as well. Mm-hmm. There's actually quite a lot of solutions out there that people just don't believe are out there, but they are. And so when you put BIPV, which is a project you probably need to do, you probably need to do your windows. When you do those windows, it's a great opportunity to also buy batteries. So the government will allow you to add so many batteries with the solar at the same time.
As part of the tax credit?
As all included in the balance of the system. So if you were to go out and buy a battery and put it in your backyard, and that's going to, you already have a solar system, and now you're going to go ahead and put in a battery, you're going to pay full price on that, and there's no tax credits. However, if you install a solar system on your roof and put in the battery at the same time, now the battery is included in that whole system. So that's the same thing with the building envelope and the BIPV. When you do the windows, you're not only doing windows, we highly recommend to maximize your battery efficiency at the same time. Get as much battery as you can when you put in any solar, because this is the future. You need batteries.
So if you do a high rise, yeah, and you're replacing all of the glass, mm-hmm, in the windows, mm-hmm, where would the batteries be kept?
So we can keep, the parking garage seems to be the best place. We can also go into electrical rooms, but really parking garages seem like the...
And how large are we talking about? How large are these batteries?
Well, on a high-rise building downtown here, we're looking at, I would say, anywhere from 2 to 4 of these batteries, which are about 40-foot containers. We're very large. However, there's very large buildings, very large power consumption needs. Part of this is, I'm sure you've heard of demand charges. Demand charges are put in by the utility to say, hey, last year you had this much. This was your worst moment last year. It was all the way up here. You might be down here for the rest of the year, but then one moment you hit here, all the pumps turn on, all the things align, and you had a maintenance guy that turned on every pump, and everything just went poof. The utility says, we have to be prepared for that amount of usage at any given moment. If we're not prepared, the whole grid will crash. So the demand charges are there to keep their grid up. If instead of that, by putting in batteries, you're actually pulling from the batteries first before going to the grid. Now, the end goal is to be off the grid, but it is hard for a downtown building ultimately to do that. There are other technologies that we can implement to basically get you off of the traditional utility.
So the glass PV that you're talking about, or those, or the PV that's in the tiles, mm-hmm, would not only create energy to operate the ongoing energy
load within the building, right?
But you could store excess.
Yes.
And that's what the batteries are for.
That's right. So generally,
that means if the power goes out, if there's a storm, that means that the building still has power.
That's right.
Okay.
So you still can have, the higher the building, the harder it is. The lower the building, the easier it is. If we have a factory, we can actually put all roof solar to some windows and put a battery and actually get you pretty close to off-grid. The other piece of the puzzle that a lot of people are talking about right now, it's really exciting stuff, is cogen plants. So the cogen plant, the solar windows, and we'll still put traditional solar on the roof, put out the solar floor tiles. This whole package putting together is really going to get you to that point where you can unplug from the utility. The difference is that you're going to a different utility. You're not really going off grid, because you're going from, perhaps these cogens are using natural gas. So you're going from one utility to now the gas utility. However, you're controlling your own power and you don't have these demand charges. And the cogen plant is so efficient, it's really amazing. The gas is pumped into the building and it turns like a generator, like your diesel generators that most people have, these big backup generators. It runs like that and the exhaust comes off and the exhaust actually heats up water. So instead of a power plant far, far away where you're pushing electrons over these wires far, far, and then all this energy to move electricity, you lose a lot of energy. But when you actually move the gas to the building and burn right there, you get all the energy right there. You get the heat captured and put that into your hot water, maybe into your pool. And it's generating electricity. And in general, these cogen plants are actually more efficient than your boilers that you're using. So instead of just boiling water, you're actually getting electricity at the same time. So what we do is we try to reduce the load in the building. First, we can do LED lighting, variable frequency drives, there's heat pumps, or we go into this cogen plant at the end. But the idea is we reduce the load, then we produce as much as we can with the building envelope, and then we come in at the end and we can put in a cogen plant to basically take care of the remaining load.
Just so that you can store the energy for use later.
So you can store the energy for use later and ultimately get to a point where you're energy independent or off the traditional utility. And the goal is that we can actually get these buildings smart enough and reduce the amount of energy that you can actually live off your batteries. You're going to have enough energy produced for self-consumption, and hopefully you have extra that you can put in. Now, it is harder on higher buildings. It is harder on a higher building. But if you, say, have a four-story building, that's a lot of roof space and a lot of windows, there's a good chance we can actually do it there. The extra energy that's produced throughout the day that you're not using, that goes into the battery, and we sort of store that out for night.
Okay, now comes the million-dollar question.
Yeah.
How much does this save? What is the saving to the association?
Of course.
That's the bottom line question.
Yeah, the real deal is the more skin in the game you have, the more you save. So in these situations where you own it yourself, you really can save quite a bit. In one example, we're looking at taking building as $50,000 a year in electrical costs, and we're looking at actually putting in a battery system and completely taking them off grid completely. So they're going to save $50,000 a year. The thing will actually pay off in about 2 years, and after that, they're going to be saving $50,000 a year. Now, that's more of a factory setting. On a regular base association, think about saving about 60%. You're going to save on your thermal load from your air conditioner. If you have a central chiller, we're going to reduce your chiller load. We're going to produce power as well. We have one example, say you have $1 million a year electrical load. It's pretty large, but if you have $1 million a year, we can actually get you down closer to like $400,000 in your electrical bill, if you're still tied to the grid.
Okay, and that's in cost savings. What about maintenance? What's the system going to cost to maintain?
Well, this is the beautiful thing for associations. Since you don't own it as the association, because we have a PPA, we have a third party owning it, and they're selling you the power, it's actually in their best interest to keep it clean. So this is one of the best lurking variables here, is that the PPA provider, the owner of the windows, will actually hire glass cleaners to come and clean the glass for you. So.
How often does this have to be done?
Well, we say two times a year. But if the production, we can remotely monitor what's going on, and if we notice that it's the production is dropping, it's a good chance that it needs to be cleaned.
So you're talking about maybe a 30-story building with all these windows replaced. Mm-hmm. The lessor, the entity that owns the windows,
yes,
while it's being financed by the association, will have to actually come out and maintain it.
This is a beautiful thing for associations because they don't have the risk. They don't have to worry about it. It's actually the third party is owning it.
But then after the 10-year period is completed, they will have to maintain it.
Yes, and so you can, after the buyout, after you would buy out the system, then you can get into an O&M agreement with us, with other companies, and you can actually have a maintenance agreement, or perhaps even handle it with internally. But you can get an O&M agreement, usually around 1-3% of the actual cost per year you throw into an O&M agreement, which is maintenance, operating and maintenance.
And so that would be like an annual contract that services would be provided.
Sure, and at that point, you've already bought out the system, and now you're actually saving all this energy, and it's unbelievable when you look at these things over 20 years, 30 years, when you actually take these numbers and you'll it's into millions and millions and millions of dollars of savings. And that's just in the energy savings. You also, right away, when you do this, you are familiar with the cap rate. You've basically improved and increased the value of this building immediately. You've dropped your operating expenses, and you're still at the same cap rate, so therefore you just increased the value of the building. So now not only are you saving energy, you just created more value in your building, which means you can loan against your building more and move your money around even further. It's really... There's really no setbacks to it. There's really no drawbacks.
Regarding the system, once it's installed, mm-hmm. how long does it last?
There's different manufacturers of different glass. Typical warranty that I've seen out there with one of ours that we work with is a 5-year warranty and a 10-year production warranty. So most solar products have two types of warranties. One of them is your all-in solar manufacturer warranty, and the other one is a output production warranty. So solar degrades over time. So there's two warranties. So far we've seen 5 and 10, 5-year warranty for just manufacturer defects, and then 10 years would be, it's guaranteed to be at 80% of what it was originally producing.
Wow. Well, geez, you know, we're running out of time.
Yeah.
And that really went fast.
It did go fast.
So you may have to come back and update us and give us more information about, yeah. you know, where this technology is going. But thank you to the viewers for tuning in. And next week, Thursday at 3 o'clock, please join us for another episode of Condo Insider. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for having me. I appreciate it.
Thank you for being with us.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Aloha, my name is Richard Emery, host of Condo Insider. More than a third of Hawaii's population live in some form of association, and our show is all about educating board members and owners about their responsibilities and obligations and providing solutions for a great association. You can watch me live on Thursdays, 3 p.m. to 4 p.m. each week. Aloha.